Hello friends. So this is the fifth lecture on Bacon, the essayist, his style, his method, his manner, his matter, then the way he uses foreign languages, influences on him, how he became a full man, what are the books that he chewed and digested, what are the books that he swallowed, what are the books that he tasted. So these things we have already seen. So today we have our focus is on Italian influence on Bacon, Machiavelli's influence on Bacon, Italian authors, and then we also see that how he used language, a foreign language, a classical language, as he used his English. Or he can say, he uses Latin as a second vernacular. That's the point. As a second vernacular means he could play with it. As you can see in the essay of cunning, of this of which we will be looking into that towards the end of this essay. But before that, let us say, now we start with the Italian influence. In the essay of superstition, he quotes from the Venetian Fra Paolo Sarpi. You can see Fra Paolo Sarpi. Then Bacon knew best Machiavelli. There is a, sometimes we are asked to write short notes on Machiavellianism in Bacon, or Bacon's, Machiavelli's influence on Bacon. Machiavelli was one of the great philosophers, the great foreign being, political, no, all of that. I don't think anybody who is doing politics, MA politics, can do away with Machiavelli. Machiavelli's theories are still valid even in the 20th century. Not only even in the 20th century, in the 20th century also, I can say. Many of the essays you should be read with Machiavelli's Discorsi sopra la prima decade di Livio. That is the title, it is written here. Discorsi, so discorsi means discourse. Sopra la prima decade di Livio. The last essay of vicissitudes of things. The last essay, 58th essay, of vicissitude of things, was clearly suggested by book 2, chapter 5 of Machiavelli's work, which is on this subject. On this subject means what subject? That is Livio. The subject of on Livio. Discorsi sopra la prima decade di Livio. It is, and also on this subject is vicissitude of things. So it is connected. If you read, if you want the full understanding of vicissitude of things, you should read this along with Machiavelli's work, this work particularly. And he says, Machiavelli says, quotes from Machiavelli says, that delusions, pestilences, change of religion and languages and other accidents, in a manner, extinguish the memory of many things. This quotation guided Bacon. I will read once again. It's very important because something that is going on now, you know, pestilence. That delusions is floods. Pestilences, pandemic like the one now we are suffering. Change of religion. Sometimes it happens. A whole group following a particular religion will totally change. There is change of religion and languages. This also happens, you know, when you are conquered by a foreign invader. This is what happened in the 10th, 11th and 12th centuries in England. When England was conquered by William Duke of Normandy, England actually, the color of England changed. The color was French, not English. You remember, no? You remember that Creoles giving prayers in churches, candidates, French is practical, fairer and fetishly. French is packful, fairer and fetishly. Upon the scholar of Stratford and Bowie, for French of Paris to hear it unknown. So she spoke French because speaking French was considered as it was a status symbol. So it is a status symbol. So the prioress tried to speak French as it is taught in the school at Stratford and Bowie, not the standard French of Paris. Standard French of Paris is very difficult for her to learn and speak. So a duplicate French that was taught in Stratford and Bowie, she spoke. French she spoke full fairy and fetishly upon the scholar of Stratford and Bowie, for French of Paris was the hearer unknown. So this can happen, change of language. And other accidents, for example, a catastrophe, cataclysm, earthquake, a massive earthquake, sir. In a massive earthquake, what will happen is sometimes hills will go down, and where you find it will be converted into a sea or a lake. So that is accidents, massive accidents. What will happen is change of language, other accidents, in a manner, extinguish means you forget or perish, so to say, the memory of many things. So many things that we hold as very, very sacred, they may change. Sometimes we may forget what our language, our religion, our way of life, our culture. If what happens, floods happen, pestilences happen, and things like that. So this is what, this is great, this is an observation of Machiavelli, practical. And you know, this is discourse on Livy, the history that made Bacon wise. This is from the discourse. Discorsi sopra li prima decca di Livy. So this is from the discourse on Livy and the discordation. And Bacon, how great was the influence? This is what made Bacon, history made Bacon wise. This history made Bacon wise. That is influence of Bacon. Machiavelli's influence on Bacon. How Bacon was influenced. Bacon himself says, we are much beholden to Machiavelli and others that wrote what men do and not what they ought to do. Very important. Isn't it? Whenever you see the spiritual sermons or religious people speaking, what do they tell us? You should do this, you should do that, you should not do it, you should not do that. But Machiavelli did not bother about that. But he was very practical. What he did was, what people did, not what people ought to do. This is not even an iota of advice that you should do this, you should do that, you should do this. But Machiavelli was so practical. He was a practical politician, and it is from him Bacon learned many things. That is, Bacon became a wise man. Bacon had pointed expression, matter of fact, philosophical summing up at the end of every essay, highly practical. So these things he learned from Machiavelli. And that's what he said, I will read out that quotation once again. He says that about Machiavelli, he says, we are much beholden because we are indebted to Machiavelli and others. Why? For what? That wrote what men do, not what they ought to do. That's the thing. Not prescriptive, but descriptive. You know, grammar, descriptive grammar and prescriptive grammar. Prescriptive is rule-based. For a run and margin, famous. That is the prescriptive. Palmer's grammar, that is descriptive. Isn't it? I have done 59 to 60 lectures, I think. Language, history of language, descriptive language, and the phonetics, phonology, morphology, syntax, transformation, generative grammar, and all those things, IC analysis, phrase structure grammar, all this. So, phrase structure grammar and so on, what do they tell us is, what does it say is, he's describing the language. So, describing, so that is description. Okay, sorry. Sorry for the digression, discourses. Now, Bacon is indebted to him because the way of his writing was influenced by Machiavelli. The principle thus clearly stated, explained, such essays as of cunning, of wisdom for a man's self and the like, what you will find is, is because of this principle, this principle stated in Of Cunning, Of Wisdom for Man's Self, etc., that Pope, Alexander Pope said, he is the wisest, brightest, and meanest of mankind. It's not only his relationship with the, or his betrayal of the Earl of Essex, but also his attitude that he learned from Machiavelli. That's why Pope says like this, the wisest, brightest, and meanest of mankind. Bacon was religious, no doubt, but he was not a moralist. Because he was very practical. Winding ways, no? You remember winding ways that he got from Machiavelli. If you want to go up in life, in inverted commas, winding ways you have to. That you have to adopt that. Crooked ways, so to say. I don't know whether this, how far is it practical, or how far we can apply this in our day-to-day life, I don't know. Because as we are concerned, we always think of dharma. Isn't it? Dharma and karma, that is our philosophy. So I don't want to make any judgment. Okay, let's proceed. Again, second digression today. I'm very sorry for that. Okay, further we'll go. Then Bacon was the most learned man of Elizabethan England. And Elizabethan time was also learned. The most learned man of Elizabethan England living in the most learned age. Underline. Right? 1,500 plays were written, and how many nest of singing birds? Already I have told you this. Latin was a second vernacular for him. His mind was unusually bright. And then, he was a scholar by instinct, underline. He was a scholar by instinct. I am not written in there. Yes. Not because something else I have explained. He was unusually, underline those things. Bacon was the most learned. The age was most learned. He was unusually bright. And he was scholar by instinct. Familiar with great Roman writers. Listen. And Bacon is the most Latinized writer. Most, I told him at the beginning, he could use Latin, he could play with the Latin, just like he could play with his great language, English. I think there is no other writer like this. Understand? When I am making such statement, you may think that it is an extreme statement. So in that case, Bodo, you can check up. Understand that you are also a scholar. Right. So he says, Latin phrases, his Latin phrases, use of English words in their Latin senses, frequent quotations from Latin, Latin proverbs, and even Latin puns you will find in his essays, rather than Latin. Any one of Bacon's Latin phrases will illustrate, will show you what a hold on English, on the English language, it is to have Latin for a second vernacular. A person who has got mastery over Latin, he will have a tremendous hold on English. You know, Latin and Greek. If you say foreign influences on Latin, we have done in the history of English language, you will find that the words that we use today, a good number of them, percentage if I say 30% or so, you find they are of Latin origin. You take any example, edible, editu, like that, imbibe, bibere. So I can give any number of examples, but not now for the time being. That will be another digression for today, for you. Okay, so he uses Latin just as he uses English. That's one of the characteristics of his style. Latin was the Latinized, the most Latinized of them, most learned of them, and a scholar by instinct, a voracious reader. And they have Latin for second language. One of the most remarkable examples is the summing up of Livy's comment on Scipio Africanus Major at the end of the essay Of Youth and Age. Of Youth and Age, says Scipio Africanus Major at the end of the essay, there is summing up. And the summing up is done by Livy. And how it has been done, we are not concerned here, but how it has been done by Bacon is important. Ultima, prima, cedeba. Three words. He did not take the summing up done by Livy. But instead, what did he do? He coined his own phrase. That from his recollection of what he remembered from Ovid. O-V-I-D, you know, Metamorphosis. So instead of taking Livy's remark or summing up on Scipio Africanus Major, what did he do? He changed it and then he recollected what Ovid had said, and he made his summing up was done in three words: Ultima, prima, cedeba. Because the meaning is the meaning of this was the last fell short of the first. Ultima, last; prima, first. So the last fell short of the first. What does that mean? Who is greater? First. The last fell short of the first. So first is the greater. But Livy sums up in two or three sentences. But Bacon does it in three words. Another example that has been shown or that has been given is Proverb 8, chapter 14. Proverb number 8. The English translation is like this. This is based on Vulgate. Vulgate means Ulgata Latin is. Common Man's Translation, St. Jerome's Translation of the Bible. So I have given this first. You see, the proverb in English: the wisdom of the prudent is to understand his way, but the folly of the fool is deceit.
That is the problem.
Now, in the Vulgate it is written, Sapientia caludis est intelligere, viam suam et imprudentia strutturum erans. You can understand the sapientia means wisdom, intelligere, intelligence, viam means way, suam his way, imprudentia, stupid person, strutturum, his stupidity, erans, makes mistake, error erans. So in the Vulgate they use 9 words, but then Bacon used it, slightly changed it. Imagine he is playing with the foreign language. And what did he do? He wrote like this: Prudence adverted ad the Jesus was, Stultus diverted ad the Dolos. Dolos means pain. The dolores means pain. Adverted means prudence adverted ad Jesu suos. Jesu suos extra means for his benefit. But stultus, stultus means foolish people. So foolish people, they diverted ad dolos. Means meaning is this one: the prudent people the wisdom of the prudent is to understand his way, but the folly of the fool is deceit. That is the meaning. But how the Vulgate translated it in Latin and how Bacon translated it in Latin? When the Vulgate used 9 words, he uses only 8 words. Plus, you can see the difference. The idiom is far much better than we cannot judge, but that is what we gather from textbooks. Bacon's way of rendering Latin, this idea, Proverb 8, chapter 14, into Latin is much better than that of St. Jerome's way of putting it. So it's something that we should understand. I hope that you are following. So, you are so brave enough to do it. That's the thing. And also you will find that how he compels a foreign language to assume forms that he wants to possess. That means he has got mastery over both Latin and his English language. He played with both. Your Latin, from Latin he is quoting, but he is changing that Latin. That's what we see. The Vulgate he took, but he changed it in his own words. Livy's summing up of Scipio Africanus, major. Scipio Africanus, major. One. What did he do? He left it. Instead, he recollected what Ovid said. And with slight changes, he said, Ultima, what did he say? Ultima prima cedeva. That is, the last fell short of the first. So 3 points today we have to see. First one is that how he was influenced by the Italians. Among the Italians, Machiavelli is influenced. Both ideas, both philosophy as well as language. And second point we saw is that he was religious but not a moralist. He was not above the political morality of those days, and that is what triggered against the Pope to say wisest, brightest and meanest of mankind. Then we saw 2 or 3 points like it. He was the most learned, most Latinized, most learned age it was. He was a scholar by instinct. How many people are there who are scholars by instinct? So he was a scholar by instinct. Then we saw how he played with English and Latin. In 2 instances we have. One is summing up of Livy. Livis Saminyam, or Livis Saminyam Pop historian, Livis Saminyam Pop, Scipio Africanus Major, he changed it to into three words. Of course, he was influenced by Ovid. Secondly, we also saw how what a mastery he had over Latin language. You could see how he changed the Vulgate Latin. Vulgate means as a Vulgata, that is common man's translation of English, from translation of the Bible into English, that of St. Jerome's Bible, that he more changed, and then he, when the Vulgate used the 9 words, he uses only 8 words. More than that, the idiom was also totally different. Those people who are masters of Latin, they say Bacon's Latin is much better than that of the Vulgate. And then we also saw that his mastery, it is really something that admirable, we can say. Admirable. He was an accomplished person for writing both in Latin and in English. I hope you are enjoying this, because being a Bacon is self. Well, we have seen the wisdom of Bacon, counsels, moral and civil, the philosophical thoughts. And philosophy comes down from the ivory towers to the streets. So then you go through the essays of Francis Bacon. See you again with another lecture. We are not concluded. There are more things to say. More things in heaven and earth, Horatio, than that are drummed off in your philosophy. Or as we say, head melodies are sweet, but those unheard are sweet. Bye. Have a nice day. Enjoy your life.